Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents This Searing Light, The Sun and Everything Else. Joy Division, The Oral History, by Jon Savage. Narrated by Liam Gerrard. Dramatis Personae. In order of appearance, as they were then. Bernard Sumner, Joy Division. Peter Hook, Joy Division. Stephen Morris, Joy Division. Deborah Curtis, wife of Ian Curtis, witness. Tony Wilson, presenter, Granada Television, factory co-founder. C.P. Lee, Alberto y los Trios Paranoias. Peter Saville, factory co-founder and art director. Paul Morley, writer, New Musical Express. Liz Naylor, writer, No City Fun. Terry Mason, Joy Division Road Manager. Ian Gray, witness. Ian Curtis, Joy Division. Mark Reeder, Factory Deutschland. Michael Butterworth, bookseller. Martin Hannet, producer and director, Factory Records. Pete Shelley, Buzzcocks. Alan Hempsall, Crispy Ambulance. Richard Boone, Buzzcocks manager. Kevin Cummins, photographer. Jeremy Kerr, A Certain Ratio. Bob Dickinson, writer, New Manchester Review. Richard Searing, Grapevine Records, Wigan Casino DJ. Rob Gretton, Joy Division manager, factory co-founder. Leslie Gilbert, partner of Rob Gretton, witness. Richard Kirk, Cabaret Voltaire. Malcolm Whitehead, filmmaker, Joy Division. John Woozencroft, witness. Lindsay Reed, wife of Tony Wilson, witness. Jill Firmanofsky, photographer. Dave Simpson, witness. Mary Harron, writer, melody maker. Annike Honore, witness. Gillian Gilbert, partner of Stephen Morris, witness. Anton Corbijn, photographer. Daniel Meadows, photographer. Dylan Jones, witness. Introduction. Bernard Sumner. I felt that, even though we were expecting this music to come out of thin air, we never, any of us, were interested in the money it might make us. We just wanted to make something that was beautiful to listen to and stirred our emotions. We weren't interested in a career or any of that. We never planned one single day. Peter Hook. Ian was the instigator. We used to call him the spotter. Ian would be sat there and he'd say, "That sounds good. Let's get some guitar to go with that." You couldn't tell what sounded good, but he could, because he was just listening. That made it much quicker, writing songs. Someone was always listening. I can't explain it. It was pure luck. There's no rhyme or reason for it. We never honestly considered it. It just came out. Stephen Morris. He was pretty private about what he wrote. I think he talked to Bernard a bit about some of the songs. It was totally different to how he appeared on stage. He was timid, until he'd had two or three breakers, malt liquor. He'd liven up a bit. The first time I saw Ian being Ian on stage, I couldn't believe it. The transformation to this frantic windmill. Deborah Curtis. He was so ambitious. He wanted to write a novel. He wanted to write songs. It all seemed to come very easily to him. With Joy Division, it all just came together for him. Tony Wilson. I still don't know where Joy Division came from. 1. The Cities Speak. Tony Wilson. I think that psychogeography and the concept of the city was at the centre of situationism in the 50s in France, and the degraded city was part of Joy Division's life. Macclesfield boys, Salford boys, and there is the city, Manchester. The idea of the city is a theme that runs through this whole thing. Manchester being the archetypal modern city. C.P. Lee. They used to say that what Manchester thinks today, London does tomorrow. And in the 19th century, this was an amazing place for innovation. Salford, which isn't part of Manchester, but sits side by side, had the first street lighting, the first trams. All these things came out of Manchester. Municipal housing, the first public lending library. All of these great, fantastic innovations that we assume are 20th century emerged in the 19th century. But at the same time, there is a tension inherent within all of this, and the tension evolves around the great unwashed, the working classes. They're there as a mob. Now, some of the movers and shakers within Manchester want to work with them and want to make things better, want to move the city on. But there are other people who regard them as very, very dangerous. So you get these tensions. So you've an area like Angel Meadows, so called because the dead were buried in such shallow ground that when it rained, it washed away the topsoil and the bones would stick out. Areas where policemen would only go round in twos. In the 30s, my father was a policeman and went round there with another officer. It was 3 in the morning and people were sat outside, and my dad said, "Why are they sat there?" And he said, "They stay there and get as drunk as possible for as long as possible, so that when they go to bed, they sleep, despite the bedbugs." You have a city which exists in great innovation, with wealth which has been generated by Cottonopolis, generated by the future, visions of the future. Things like the ship canal, which is fantastic. The sea is 30 miles away at Liverpool, but Manchester doesn't sit there and take it. It says, "We'll bring the sea to the city," and they build the ship canal, and it comes here, and it's fantastic. There are docks in Salford. It becomes known as the Barbary Coast, and it's full of dusky Lascars. It's full of Italianates. It's full of Mediterraneans and Spaniards who swan around with earrings and neck scarves, and it's fantastic. There are men with monkeys on their shoulders. The docks bring in everything to Manchester, and it becomes a fantastically opulent melting pot of different influences and different styles. But at the same time, underneath it is an underbelly of the working classes, who haven't exactly got a slice of the cake. In the early years of the 19th century, you have a massive political movement which starts developing in the northwest of England, and it's the Chartists, and it's the free traders. And what they basically want is what we have now, which is universal suffrage. They have a massive demonstration in 1819 at St Peter's Field in Manchester. And what do you do when people want the vote? You send in the cavalry. And the cavalry and the yeomanry went in and massacred the crowds that were there. Hundreds were injured, 15 dead, probably more. This was celebrated by the erection through public subscription of the Manchester Free Trade Hall, which becomes a gigantic epicentre of psychogeographical energy. Every major artist and musician of the 20th century appeared in the Free Trade Hall. It was the site of political debate. When trade unions went on strike, they had their meetings there. Louis Armstrong played there. Bob Dylan was booed and heckled there in the Free Trade Hall in 1996. The Sex Pistols played there in 1976. And in 1996, the Dalai Lama did his last blessing to the people of Manchester in there. It was built on a field drenched in the blood of the dead. And that's what makes Manchester unique. Because you have this fantastic dichotomy between the haves and the have-nots, the rich and the poor, the thinkers and the non-thinkers. And it's a tension, and it's an energy, which has made it the vital and important place that it is today. Tony Wilson. Two words were redolent of the northern cities of Britain, and in particular Manchester. One was the word slum. I always hear Laurence Olivier in my ear for Granada saying, "You're a slum, slug," in one of those Pinter plays. Slums were dirty working-class housing, and the other word is unemployment. Those are the two words, the S word and the U word. And then you add the word dirt. It was a dirty, dirty old town. And I think we had to struggle to remember that this had been the historic centre of the modern world, that we invented the Industrial Revolution in this town, that, even though we did, we also invented these conditions. I've only recently got round to reading Elizabeth Gaskell and the novel Mary Barton, and essentially communism came about because Marx and Engels just looked at this utter shite that was the first industrial city. The great triumph of Manchester in the mid-19th century was that the first great industrial city had fallen apart after the American Civil War, and delightfully from a Mancunian point of view. That's because we sided with our non-business partners. Our business partners were the plantation owners, but every time that the South and Richmond tried to get recognition for the Confederacy, it was stopped by the Manchester workers rioting, and Westminster would pull back from recognising the South. That's why we have a Lincoln Square in Manchester. Most people in Manchester don't know why we have a Lincoln Square, because no one can really read the inscription. But President Lincoln wrote a letter to the working people of Manchester, saying that, in all our struggles to overcome this evil, one of the most significant forces helping us has been you, the people of Manchester. The one difference is that you have done it against your own best interests, because, far from finding ourselves with our business partners, the plantation owners, we felt we had more in common with the black slaves, which is probably very true. Anyway, that left us fucked, and also by that point in time the major economic factor in business had become shipping. Freightage. There's a wonderful statistic from around 1870. To get a ton of coal from New York to Liverpool cost 6 and 4 pence. To get the same ton of coal from Liverpool to Manchester would then cost 8 and 6 pence. So basically, not having a port, we were fucked. And in true Mancunian spirit, a bunch of Mancunians in some hotel one night said, "Right, we're going to build the Port of Manchester." So we went ahead and dug a canal from the bottom of the Mersey Bay into Manchester. And it didn't work because all the modern factories were on the Mersey at the Liverpool end and there was no reason to come down the ship canal. But then someone said, "Why don't we build somewhere that's specifically for modern factories?" And then we built the world's first industrial estate, which is Trafford Park. And that made the ship canal work. That's why my parents' shop was half a mile from the entrance to the port of Manchester in Salford. Bernard Sumner. You were always looking for beauty, because it was such an ugly place, whether again on a subconscious level. I mean, I don't think I saw a tree till I was about 9. I was surrounded by factories and nothing that was pretty. Nothing. So it gave you an amazing yearning for things that were beautiful, because you were in a semi-sensory deprivation situation, because you were brought up in this brutal landscape. But then when you did see something or hear something that was beautiful, you would go, "Oh, new experience," and really appreciate it. I remember being on my scooter when I was a scooter boy and driving up on the moors and not being able to believe all these open spaces. It gave me the freedom to move around, just going up on the moors in the middle of winter, taking the day off school. There was all snow everywhere, going up there and just looking and thinking, amazingly beautiful. And that has stuck with me till today. The hills are the escape from it, from the horrible industrial dead landscape of Salford and most of Manchester. The sheer contrast between the moors and the industrial filth that surrounded us in the 60s. I remember someone telling me on the way home from school that Salford was considered the biggest slum in Europe, and I couldn't believe it, because it was where I lived. I read that living in Salford was the equivalent of smoking 70 cigarettes a day. Tony Wilson. Salford and Manchester are virtually the same place. In a helicopter, you'd have to come very low to make out the River Irwell that separates the two great cities. And yet there used to be this real conflict, in that typically, if people in America say, "Oh, you come from Manchester," people like me say, "No, I don't, I come from Salford." The same thing. No, it's not. Salford had its own sense of pride. It was a city 800 years before Manchester was a city. It felt like the working-class city on the edge of the urban centre of Manchester. I think one of the strange things about the whole process, when you look at the regeneration of this great city region, which is now the way we call it, one of the moments comes in the mid-80s when suddenly people like me would go, I come from Manchester, and that's when the word Manchester came to represent the project. A project to rebuild this drastically cut down, dirty, filthy, derelict estate that was Manchester and Salford. Bernard Sumner. I was actually raised in Salford in Lower Broughton, a place called Alfred Street, number 11, with my grandparents and my mother. It was actually good. I'm supposed to say, oh God, it was awful, it was a grim, dreadful place. It was just factories everywhere. We had a chemical factory at one end of our street and a family of local thugs at the other end, but it made life interesting. There was a lot of funny characters living round there, and loads of pubs right near the River Irwell, so there was a lot of midges in the summer, I remember. But you could walk everywhere. My primary school was about 5 minutes walk away, but it didn't stop me being late every single day. I used to get in terrible trouble because I was late, and the teachers used to go, but you only live 5 minutes away, how is that possible? It was a good laugh, really. Could be violent. I got chased by a gang with spears one day. That was quite frightening. I've been chased by a gang with sabres, seen women fighting in the street, people getting beaten up with iron bars. But I'd move back there any day. At least it's not guns. It was rough. I know it's a cliche, but there was a fantastic sense of community. I guess what happened in the 60s was that someone at the council decided that the chemical factory in my street and my area wasn't very healthy, and something had to go. And unfortunately, it was my neighbourhood that went. What then happened was my mother married when I was 11, so we then moved out of my grandparents' house and moved just across the River Irwell to a place called Greengate. It was a tower block, which I thought was fantastic. I thought, this is like moving to New York. It's got central heating. We've got a bath. And we've got an airing cupboard for drying out all your towels. So I thought, this is it. It's like Buckingham Palace. I loved the tower blocks. I loved the way Manchester was being remodelled. To me, they were changing it into New York, and that equaled excitement and the future. The first thing I did was sit in the airing cupboard and put the heating on full and pretend it was a sauna. I thought, great, it's a sauna, it's a palace. I was wrong about that. It was a horrible place to live, just because primarily you lost that community spirit that we had on the other side of the river. Everyone knew everyone. On a nice summer's day, everyone would sit outside and talk to each other. You lost all that. It was like living in a prison for that reason. You had the home comforts, but it was an isolating experience. Peter Hook. I was born in Oddsall in Salford, and I was raised there for most of my life, apart from a brief 3-year stint when I lived in Jamaica for some strange reason. Salford's special, and Manchester isn't. I'm not proud of it. Salford has a very stubborn and very aggressive reputation, whereas Manchester's just Manchester. It's always been a struggle living in Salford. It's very, very poor, very downtrodden, very industrial. It's interesting when Bernard says that unknown pleasures came from that, which I suppose it did. I don't think consciously Bernard and I were struggling to get out of it. I think we were quite happy with our lot, to be honest. But I suppose, subconsciously, it would have a big effect on you. Stephen Morris. When I was growing up, we used to come to Manchester and go back again. I remember the first time in Manchester, seeing all these end-to-end terraced houses. And then, the next time you went, there was just a pile of rubble. Then the next time you went, there was all this building work. Then, by the time you were in your teens, it was this big concrete fortress, quite futuristic at the time. The College of Music was there, and Oxford Road was futuristic in the 70s. There were grim bits, but compared to Macclesfield, it was the bright lights. Peter Saville. The geography of Manchester is quite particular. The city seems to radiate outwards in bands. Hardly anybody lived in the centre of Manchester. And from that point of view, it's unlike London or even Liverpool, or more historic cities like Bristol. The residential areas of Manchester developed beyond the immediate city centre, and during the course of the 19th and certainly during the 20th century, the desirable residential areas moved further and further out. It's a relatively modest-sized city, so you can live out on the edges of Greater Manchester, but commute in and out of the city in 20 or 45 minutes, depending on the time of day. I lived out in South Manchester, on the borders of Cheshire, in the stockbroker belt. And while I was at art college, I had this daily journey into the centre of the city. I didn't really appreciate what it showed to me at the time. It was something that I'd just absorbed subconsciously. I didn't really notice until I lived in central London, and then realised the actually much more uniform social and geographic engagement when you live in the centre of a large city like London. Having been away from Manchester for a few years, I realised that that journey from the edges of the city in was taking me every day through a cross-section of the social profile of the UK. You witness many types of life and work and activity and ways of living in that half-hour journey in and out of Manchester. You see semi-rural farmland, and you see suburbia, and you see tough inner-city areas where life is a lot more difficult and a demanding experience for people. And then you come into the business, professional, retail, city centre. I think it's actually quite a healthy experience. Things are not hidden from you. The spectrum of life is there. Where I grew up afforded me a certain kind of romantic vision of the city, of an industrial city, or at least by that stage a post-industrial city. I found the factories and the warehouses exciting. I wasn't having to eke out an existence among them. They were a sort of sculpture park for me. Paul Morley. You didn't have to walk far out of the city centre for it to just fall apart and become nothing. It was bombed and had never really been repaired. You didn't really ever feel it would be built up and turned into anything. You felt that would be it forever. Liz Naylor. Nobody lived there. There was nothing there. It was a post-industrial city. It was empty. I loved walking round there. I can feel how it felt in 1978. I can walk down Tibb Street, which is now the Northern Quarter. But to me, it is forever 1978. And also, I can really picture the old Eighth Day in All Saints, and now it's very different from the small shop it was. It was just a really amazing way of experiencing the city for me as a young woman. I was always on my own as well. It wasn't like I was truanting with a gang of kids. It was a very solitary experiencing of the city, and I wasn't frightened of it. I was very much in love with its decay, because of course it completely matched my depression. I wasn't badly behaved. I was just enormously depressed and suicidal, so wandering round Manchester in the late 70s was absolutely perfect. It was the thing I wanted to do. It was like the collision between pre-war Manchester and the post-war raising of all that and the building of new slums. So the two slums were existing side by side. It was like a bomb site, North Manchester. It was terrifying. I used to have to walk into town, so I'd walk up Oldham Road and Rochdale Road, which at that point were really grim places. It was full of abandoned buildings with no windows and bomb sites. The war was there again. The city at that time was just overrun by the dispossessed, and I felt extremely dispossessed and disempowered. And it's the most at home I have ever felt living anywhere. Joy Division felt very close to me. They were my first band. I think they were a band that really appealed to outsiders, you know, and girls. I might not have felt like a girl, but I was a girl, and I was quite vulnerable, and they really connected with me. My thing about Joy Division is they're an ambient band almost. You don't see them function as a band. It's just the noise around where you are. 2. 1966 to 76. Bernard Sumner. I was really into music. When I was 16, my mother said, "What do you want for Christmas?" I said, "A guitar." She bought this Gibson SG copy, and then when I got it, I didn't know what to do with it, because you've really got to play with other people. So I left it there for years, gathering dust in the corner of the room, and it really bugged me, because I don't like wasting. I wanted to see what potential it had, so that's why I wanted to form a band. I liked music. I didn't want to waste the present. I wanted to see what I could do with it. It was in the corner of the room, and it kept nagging at me. Use me. Use me. C.P. Lee. Up until 1966, there were over 200 beat clubs in the Manchester area, and it was a very happening city. Even after 1966, the amount of beat clubs that turned themselves into cabaret premises was massive, and Bernard Manning once said that it was a license to print money to open a club in Manchester. It was definitely an epicentre. Coach parties used to come from as far away as Nottingham, because they knew that the nightlife was cheap, thrilling, and fantastic. In the 60s, the city centre was, in a sense, given over to hedonism. There were lots and lots of empty factory spaces, lots and lots of empty mill spaces, so there were an increasing number of hotels that were cheap and available. There were direct road and rail routes, which made it cheap and easy to access. And there was a willing segment of the population who were prepared to provide entertainment, and so music in Manchester has always been integral to the city's life. From the 19th century onwards, you'd have hurdy-gurdy bands, street bands, every pub had music or one form or another. This is pre-jukebox, so live music was de rigueur in lots of places in Manchester. Then, in the 60s, the beat boom fed into the cabaret club, then into the disco boom. For live musicians, though, it got quite difficult by the end of the decade. There was one specific chief constable, a dour Scotsman called Mackay, who decided to crush the beat clubs, and the closure of live music venues meant that earning a living got more and more difficult. Tony Wilson. Manchester had always been a club city, and we'd had a wonderful club in the 60s called the Twisted Wheel, where people would take Purple Hearts and Speed and see Eric Clapton and the great blues people for the first time. So there was a history and a tradition of culture, but basically, this was in defiance of the economic downturn. C.P. Lee. The crackdown in the 60s on youth led to a dearth of live music. Put that hand in hand with the beginning of the rise in unemployment, and a feeling that teenagers had been blanked out of all these opportunities. There was a greyness that we might associate with the eradication of red brick terraced housing and its replacement by concrete gulags, a feeling of hopelessness that was matched by the aspirations of the time. You needed little more than a colour TV and a tight pair of shoes to have achieved success, but people wanted more than that. Teenagers were being fed a dreadful diet of garbage within popular music. It had become a leviathan, a great bewildered beast that shrugged its shoulders and off-dropped Genesis or off-dropped the Electric Light Orchestra, groups that grew too big for their own boots, groups that had pantechnicons that delivered the carpets that they would put the drum kits on so they could play the stadiums. That was the disenfranchisement of the young. Kids want to be part of rock music. They don't just want to be observers. They want to be participants. Bernard Sumner. I managed to pass me 11 plus, went to Salford Grammar. I was sat in the back of the class for every lesson because I wasn't really bright enough to be there, I don't think. Not academically, anyway. I noticed this other guy sat at the back of the class as well, called Peter Hook. So we sort of wasted our time together there. I just couldn't see the point of anything they were teaching me. I just thought, well, what's the point of logarithms? How can I use that in my life? The first thing that got me interested in music was spaghetti western music, Ennio Morricone. When I was 16, I went to see The Good, the Bad and the Ugly. We didn't have a record player in our house. We just had a radio. And I wasn't really interested in music. But when I saw those images, the way it was filmed with the music, I found it incredibly powerful. It was a revelation. I remember when Jimi Hendrix died, and I couldn't understand it. It just sounded like noise to me. I remember sitting next to this guy at school. Do you like Jimi Hendrix? He went, yeah. So I said, well, there's no tune in it. It just sounds like a load of fucking noise. So he just turned round and said, I like it. and wouldn't expand on it at all. That got me intrigued, so I went out and bought the record, played it about 5 times and then went, ah, I get it now. There was a big culture of music at Salford Grammar School. It was a very exciting time for music. We used to go to a youth club called North Salford Youth Club, which was opposite Lower Broughton Baths, and they used to have 2 rooms there. The room down below, which was the disco where you played Tamla Motown and Stax and Scar. And then the upstairs, they used to have another room where they used to play the Stones and Led Zeppelin and Free and Jimi Hendrix. So there was a real culture of music there, and it was very important to us. Apart from that, I don't think we had any identity. The school I went to was really big, and I guess living in Salford, you were a bit of a nobody. You didn't have much chance of progressing in the world. You were thought of as factory fodder. Music gave you a sense of identity, and it was a grim place, and the winters were very long, so you'd tend to become internalised. It's not like living in LA, where you can go roller skating down the beach every day. It was like, oh shit, this is really boring. It's foggy outside, it's raining. What are we going to do? I know, let's go up so-and-so's house. Let's take a load of records and talk about music. And that developed into, let's start making music. Terry Mason. I've known Hookie since I was 8. Bernard I didn't get to know till I was at secondary school, and I met him in the 3rd year because the school had been in 2 parts. There was Salford Technical High School and Salford Grammar School. Hookie and Bernard went to the same school. I went to the technical high school, and despite making these choices on where we wanted to go, by the 3rd year they threw us all together. We got more friendly when we were 16 and we all had scooters. A scooter gang isn't the right sort of terminology, but at that point there was maybe 10 of us in our year at school who all had scooters, and we'd meet up with each other after school. Although Hookie and Barney lived in different areas to where I was, they would come fairly close to where I lived. We were just oikes with scooters. There was no Parkers, there was no Union Jacks and RAF Roundels. Peter Hook. I met Bernard in Salford Grammar School when we were 11. We became friends very quickly. Bernard and I weren't part of the bullied, and we weren't really part of the bullying. We were in the middle of it all, so it was quite a privileged existence as a child. I started going out about 16. The first club we went to was Salford Rugby Club, at the Willows on a Monday, and then progressed to a Tuesday, and a lot of our school friends went there. It was easier for me to go than for Bernard because I could walk home. He lived in Broughton, so it became my hangout. It was all just 70s rock, Slade, Deep Purple, Hendrix, Groundhogs, Status Quo. We went to see Led Zeppelin at the Hard Rock in Stretford, Deep Purple at the Free Trade Hall, and things like that. Heavy rock. That lasted until we started going out, and we started to get into pop, because we started hearing it. We didn't hear any disco until we went to clubs. Terry Mason. Well, it was a grammar school, but it didn't do any of us that much good, to be honest. Between the 3 of us, we had 5 O-levels. It wasn't the time when everyone was expected to go to university. There was maybe 120, 150 people in our year, and the number of people going to university from that school would maybe be 4. You were expected just to go off and get some sort of a job. There were no great designs. It wasn't well known for producing doctors. I think it produced quite a number of lathe operators and machinists, but there was no academic excellence about the school. The factory for Salford was Ward and Goldstone, an electrical factory, but it didn't have any appeal for any of us. Bernard Sumner. I had a pretty wild time at school. I felt that being young was a time to enjoy myself, so I didn't knuckle down at my studies. What I wanted to do was go out chasing after girls, go shoplifting in Manchester, and do the incredibly stupid things that schoolboys do. When I left school, I wanted to go to art college. I had a small portfolio of artwork that I'd done at school, and went to Bolton College of Art, and I got accepted. So I went home and told my mother, and she said, no. I said, what? I want to go to art college. She said, I can't afford it. She got an uncle to talk to me, which was very strange because he was a real distant uncle who I didn't really like, because he lived in a big house in Worsley, probably. He said, "Look, you can't go to art college. You've got to go out and get a job, support yourself." So I had to shelve that idea and I got a job. My mother knew a local councillor and he pulled a few strings and I got a job at Salford Town Hall in the Treasury Department, sending out rates demands. Not something you dream of when you're at school. I mean, my worst thing was mathematics at school. I was absolutely appalling at it. They used to give me 10,000 rate demands a day, and I used to have to put them in envelopes, line them up on my hand, and they had a roller that you wet, and you'd just put them down, seal all the envelopes, put them in a franking machine and send them off. Real life came to me as a horrible shock. Jesus, wake up! This is what real life is. Unless you wriggle out of this, like a snake, life is going to be dismal. I decided I wanted to do something in art. I'd been to see the careers advisor at school, and he said, "Well, I've got you two jobs. One is a hairdresser," and I said, "That's nothing to do with art. And the other is, you know, photographs?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "You know the white borders on the photographs?" I said, "Yeah." He said, "Your job is cutting the white borders off, so there's no borders on them." I was like, "No way, bollocks to that." So what I did was I got the yellow pages down, and me and my then girlfriend wrote to every advertising agency in Manchester and said, "Can you give us a job?" I actually got two, and I actually did both jobs at the same time. Don't know how I managed that. One was in an advertising agency doing newspaper work, and the other was in a place that was doing TV commercials and graphics, but both really as messenger boy, sort of tea boy. I did one week, and I did the other the next. The one that did TV commercials was really good, because everyone was pretty cool there. It was in the media, and everyone was really into music. We had a record player where we worked, and people used to bring music in, but because they were much older than me, they fucking hated my records. They used to whinge on about them. They used to listen to stuff like Van Morrison, and I used to bring in Led Zeppelin. Turn it down, it's just a bloody noise. But they were a really good crowd, and I enjoyed my time working with those people. Terry Mason. Basically, after Bowie's first entrance, the music world seemed to go very quiet. There was a lot of long hair music about that had no interest. A lot of people were looking for the next thing. We were all a little bit too young to get the benefit of Bowie. We weren't in a position where we could have been in a band. Mind you, there weren't many people that were capable of doing it anyway at that point. After that, we went to all sorts of things. Edie and the Hot Rods, AC/DC. That was a year before the Pistols. We'd seen the Kersal Flyers, Dr. Feelgood. We kept going to gigs on the periphery, not the mainstream. Deep Purple would still come through town every 2 years, but we wouldn't go to stuff like that. We would go to bands that were on at the university, which in itself was a challenge for us, because in them days it was students' union card holders only. Bernard Sumner. I had a scooter, and Hookie had a scooter, and we used to go to pop festivals. We used to go to watch groups play at the Free Trade Hall and the university campuses in Manchester, but 9 times out of 10 they wouldn't let us in, because we were scooter boys or skinheads, and they didn't like the look of us. We were actually from the town, but we didn't have an SU card. I think that was the excuse. We used to go and see groups, whoever played. Lou Reed at the Free Trade Hall. There was a massive riot at the end of it. The riot was great, but he was great as well, because he was just completely fucked all the time. He didn't do an encore, so some kid, and I saw him because he was quite close to me. He was like a Rod Stewart clone. Had a bottle of beer, and he threw it, and it was a lucky shot. It went straight through the skin of the bass drum, and then everyone started punching him, and it all went up. We used to go to a club called Pips on Fennel Street, near the back of Manchester Cathedral, and it had different rooms. It had a Northern Soul room, a room that played David Bowie and Roxy music, and another room that played soul music. If you went in pairs and had an older mate, you could just about get in there when you were 17. Ian Gray. Mostly Bowie fans would go there. Pips was the one place where I used to see Barney and Hookie. I never saw Ian Curtis there, but I saw those two. You'd get to recognise people. That was the one club you could go to in Manchester. Other than that, it was a very grim place. Still very Victorian buildings, a lot of bomb sites, decayed buildings, nothing new. Stephen Morris. Macclesfield used to have a place where bands played called the El Rio, and there was a long-standing story of you'd always meet someone in a pub. I remember when the Beatles' van broke down in Chestergate and me and him over there, we pushed the van. But that was dead and gone, so there was no live entertainment, nowhere for groups to play. I remember there was a cafe that we used to frequent, Aggie's Caff. It had a jukebox, which was the main thing, and you'd go in and put a record on. And Aggie would come out and say, "What the bloody hell have you done that for?" Then she'd unplug the machine. And that was Macclesfield to a T, really. There wasn't a lot to do apart from drink underage. I was a staunch advocate for it at the time. If you wanted any form of musical entertainment, you had to come to the big city, which meant getting on a train and getting off at Piccadilly Station and going to see bands at the Free Trade Hall in Manchester. You'd made it then, when you could get off the train and you've got your 2 and 6 pence to see Rod Stewart and the Faces, the Kinks, Bowie. Sometimes I'd just go and buy a ticket, and I ended up seeing Gentle Giant that way. That was what you had to do. You had to get out of Macclesfield, because there was absolutely nothing. Nothing at all. I attended the King's School in Macclesfield, which Ian Curtis attended. He was a year or two above me. He was a prefect, and I was a bad boy. Yes, solvent abuse and cough medicine was quite a favourite of mine. When they discovered that the contents of my desk were not the reference books that should have been there, but empty bottles of cough medicine and dry cleaning fluid, I was shown the door post-haste, and Ian, who I must have seen but probably in a fuddled haze, failed to recognise, had the job of going round inspecting the other pupils' pupils for signs of dilation, which was apparently the telltale sign of a cough-linctus fiend. Ian Curtis. Interviewed by Paul Rambali, NME, 11th of August 1979. Everyone's living in their own little world. When I was about 15 or 16 at school, I used to talk with me mates and we'd say, "Right, as soon as we leave, we'll be down in London, doing something nobody else is doing." Then I used to work in a factory, and I was really happy because I could daydream all day. All I had to do was push this wagon with cotton things in it up and down. But I didn't have to think. I could think about the weekend, imagine what I was going to spend my money on, which LP I was going to buy. You can live in your own little world. Deborah Curtis. Ian's parents used to live in Huddersfield, which is towards the hills. Very neat, very clean. And why they asked for a transfer to those flats at Victoria Park, Macclesfield, I'll never understand. It was ridiculous. His dad's a bit of a dark horse. He was a policeman. I don't think Ian communicated with his parents very well. They don't like to believe anything bad about him. Stephen Morris. Ian used to work in Rare Records. It does shame me to mention it, but I can remember going in there and seeing if they had the Jobriath record. Jobriath, who was Morris's hero, and thinking, "Oh, I'll come back and get that next week. Nobody's going to buy that." And then the week after, it had gone. I can only assume that Morrissey got that. Certainly a lot of people in the punk movement hung about in the basement of Rare Records, and Ian was one of them, but I can't remember ever buying a record off him. Mark Reeder. I met Ian when he was working at Rare Records. They were very elitist in that shop, all beards and long hair, tweed jackets, and they all thought they were something else. I always thought if I ever worked in a record shop, I'd never want to be like them. Totally unhelpful, ignorant of the people coming into the shop. If you made a mistake in the pronunciation of a track, you'd be ridiculed to death. Ian wasn't like that. He was always trying to sell me reggae records. This was about 1974. Ian was totally into reggae music, dub. He wasn't there very long, about a year, and he was the youngest one in the shop. And he was the only one you could talk to. We talked about all kinds of stuff, and usually the topics would cross over from music to history and the war. He was fascinated by the war. I started working at Virgin Records when I was about 14, just part-time initially, and I got paid in records. They needed someone to stock up the records on weekends while they were all in the shop. Just helping out. And then I ended up working there. It was back in the 70s, real hippie days. Lots of long hair and tashes and stuff. There was this seating arrangement because people kept stealing headphones. They'd either break or they'd be nicked. So somebody came up with this idea where they'd have this seating arrangement at the back, covered in this vomit green brine nylon carpet covering, and the loudspeakers were put in the headrests, and people would sit, obviously, next to each other, and it was impossible to hear anything. You could move these speakers, put them next to your ears in the hope that you could not hear the person next to you. But Virgin was a place where people just liked to hang out, really. That's why it stank of incense in there as well, to disguise the smell of marijuana. It was more rock music than disco then. In 1973, they'd just had this massive success with Tubular Bells, and then came Tangerine Dream. And they were the kind of records that put Virgin on the map and made the Virgin shop in Manchester special. All the other record shops were a bit elitist. I was captivated by the idea of electronic music. I remember in 1968 when you had to have a stereo. We'd seen some bloke offering them in the paper, so one Saturday afternoon we went round to this bloke's house to look at this stereo. It was this massive thing stuck in the middle of the room like a cabinet, a sideboard with loudspeakers at each end and a drinks bit in the middle. And to demonstrate this stereo, he put on Switched on Bach by Walter Carlos. And I was like, what is that? Before that, my only exposure to electronic music had been Doctor Who and Telstar. Then, for years and years, I didn't hear anything synthetic at all, until I came to this bloke's house, and he put on Switched on Bach, which was like the Brandenburg Concerto played on a synthesizer. I'd been exposed to classical music because I played violin at school, but this was something completely different. And it was in stereo. From that moment, I was captivated by the idea of electronic music. In the Court of the Crimson King came out when I was about 10, and I was just overawed. It was avant-garde, ambient, and I'd sit in total silence listening to this record, looking at the cover, absorbing it all. And that was my background to working in Virgin. When they started releasing the early Tangerine Dream records, German music didn't sound like British music at all. And the weirder it was, the more fascinated I was. The first Kraftwerk albums were like jazz rock, with flutes and stuff, totally unlistenable to for all my mates. I knew Tony Wilson from very early on. He'd come in at weekends just before closing time. I was the person designated to unpack the boxes in the morning and then write up all the records and put them into stock. So I knew every single record that was coming into the shop, even more than the people who actually worked there. I'd have to tell them what had come in. They had no idea. They'd just look at the list and they had no idea if things they'd ordered had actually come in or not. Tony would ask me to put a record aside for him so he could have a listen. Then I could put it back in stock on the Monday if he didn't want it. He'd come in and it would be all, "Darling," and that's how I got to know him. I got to know Rob Gretton because he used to come into the shop all the time and just hang around. It's what I would do as well. Go into record shops and just hang around there all day, talking about records and about music. Ian would come into Virgin when he started working in Manchester and just hang around, complaining about things. He said, "You can smell the drugs in Virgin." I told him that's why we burn incense to disguise it, but he thought that was the smell of the drugs. He was always joking, very funny, playing tricks and stuff. Paul Morley. We had head shops like 8 Miles High, the Manchester Free Press and the Mole Express, and the lefty end of things. That was your great salvation at the time. Music and the lefty press and the bookshops where alternative culture seemed to be thriving. Down in London, obviously, there was Compendium, and we had weird little versions of that where you might find some sanity and discover things. Everything was not easily available. You had to search it out and find it. I worked in this bookshop in Stockport, and the shop sold all the great Pelican Blue books, which were my education. I didn't get educated at school. I got educated in this bookshop, and they had a science fiction section. Harlan Ellison's Dangerous Visions, all the J.G. Ballard novels. They would have underground magazines, and weird folk singers from the backwoods of Derbyshire would come in to get their weekly fix of odd alternative culture. But we made money in the bookshop out of the soft porn and the Mills and Boone, so you had a strange thing where old ladies would totter in every month to get their 10 Mills and Boone, and men would come in to get the soft porn, which we had to order off a van that came in every week. Then I would be selling second-hand records. I would go into Manchester, buy bootlegs for £2, bring them back to my bookshop and sell them for £2.50. You'd get the people coming in to buy war books, all those Sven Hassels. Of course, if you were going to open that kind of independent bookshop in the Northwest at that period, you would have lefty tendencies, so you'd be pushing that. But to make money, you would have to sell White Horse and Mayfair. And the dreadful thing is, you could bring them back to exchange, so these grubby copies of this soft porn would come back, glistening with some suspect substance. But what was interesting were the creatures that would come in to check out the weird combination of books, which sounds fairly standard now, but at the time was unformed and raw. Ballard and Philip K. Dick and Burroughs. William Burroughs was definitely part of it. They were prophets of something that we were about to enter. This commercial entertainment landscape that would become where we are now sat. But at the time, it was very odd. And it was a beautiful attachment to your love for weird music. There was no doubt that it was connected. There didn't seem to be any difference between reading Ballard and Dick and Burroughs and listening to Faust and Velvet Underground and Iggy and the Stooges. You were constantly curious to find out strange things that might explain your situation, even though it didn't directly have anything to do with where you were. And there were characters. There was a guy that used to come into the bookshop called Paul, and he did the first fanzine I'd ever come across. It was called Penetration, and it was basically obsessed with Hawkwind. He used to come in and he always used to wear all black. He had the whitest skin I'd ever seen, and his girlfriend would always wear white lace, and they used to float in, bringing 10 copies of Penetration every so often. In fact, that's where I first wrote. I wrote a piece about Lenny Bruce for Penetration, which Paul pasted up in the wrong order. Incidentally, I think it's influenced my writing ever since, because I quite liked it being in the wrong order. But there were lots of characters like that floating around, and obviously Ian Curtis. I get the sense wherever he was at the same time, 74, 75, he was coming across similar sorts of routes, similar source material out of which he could piece together his vision. Stephen Morris. I'd get the train and go into Savoy Books. Before it was Savoy Books, it was called The House on the Borderlands. And we used to have a right laugh at the old blokes looking at the porn. There was science fiction, weird books, and over in a corner there'd be naked ladies, and surprisingly enough, the science fiction had little appeal for the vast majority of the clientele, who were going over to the naked lady corner. I'd just be trying to negotiate some sort of discount on a large expensive book. Yeah, have you got Michael Moorcock's new book? Ian had The Atrocity Exhibition by Ballard, Naked Lunch, William Burroughs, and also a collection of Jim Morrison's poems. I seem to remember that you could go to W.H. Smith's and they had a lot of Burroughs's and a lot of Ballard, and it was just mixed in with the rest of the stuff. Michael Butterworth. Book Chain was opened in 1977. It was alternative and youth culture stuff, both second-hand and new. I must clarify, though, that this was the most famous of our shops and the one everyone remembers, but it is not the shop Ian Curtis first came to. There were two Savoy shops before this one, and David Britton's most vivid memories of Ian are of him coming into the first shop. All three shops were modelled on two London bookshops of the period. Bram Stokes's shop in Berwick Street, Soho, called Dark They Were, and Golden-Eyed, which sold comics, sci-fi, drug-related stuff, posters, etc., and a chain called Popular Books. David Britton used to visit a branch of the latter in Camden Town when he was living in London in the late 60s. They sold everything from Private Eye, girly books, pin-up stuff, and Penthouse, to film stills, posters, and any sort of media ephemera. These two bookshops inspired David with his then-partner, Charles Partington, to open a bookshop on Port Street, off Newton Street in Manchester Centre. The shop they opened was called The House on the Borderland, after the William Hope Hodgson novel. And they had all this kind of stuff in the window. There was a strong emphasis on alternative culture and American imports. The window looked very exotic, and this is what probably attracted Ian and Steve Morris inside, once they had followed the yellow brick road poster trail leading to the shop. The attitude radiating from the shop was, "Fuck everybody in authority," and that's what they responded to. The shop played loud rock and roll over the speakers, which sounded out into the street years before other shops were doing the same kind of thing. And I mean loud. They were disparate, alienated young men attracted to like-minded souls. They wanted something offbeat and off the beaten track, and the shop supplied this. They probably saw the shop as being a beacon in the rather bleak Manchester of the early 70s. Ian was interested in counterculture and science fiction. David remembers them being enthusiasts about Michael Moorcock, whose hard-edged fantasy writing and lifestyle were a great influence, very rock and roll. Ian bought second-hand copies of New Worlds, the great 60s literary magazine edited by Moorcock, which was doing something very different, promoting Burroughs and Ballard, and it's possible Ian picked up his interest in these writers from these magazines. In exchange for their help in the shop, they were allowed to take whatever books took their fancy. They came in every couple of weeks, sometimes more often. Steve was the most frequent. This close contact came to an end gradually, as Ian and Steve's interest in a band was getting more serious. Stephen Morris. Once I started going out, my first concert was Hawkwind and Status Quo. I was into psychedelic music, really. Apart from Hawkwind, the first two groups that I got into were Frank Zappa and the Mothers of Invention, and the week after that it was the Velvet Underground, and that was it. I liked collecting groups, and I remember I liked Alice Cooper until everybody else started liking Alice Cooper, and then I decided I didn't really like Alice Cooper that much. That's a bit pretentious, really, but that's the way it was. After that, glam happened. Actually, after saying that Macclesfield was a cultural desert, once a year there was a discotheque. There were two discotheques, one at the rugby club where you could go and dance to The Faces and Jeff Beck and get in a fight, or you could go to Boddington Civic, which was later on, where there was a big glam rock following, and you had the Sweet and Bowie and Roxy music. And so we went from psychedelic to glam rock, again, till everybody started liking it. I discovered krautrock about that time, and can. I was into Tago Mago. I should say we were forming a band, me and this other guy from school, Mac, he was called. We were going to form this avant-garde jazz combo called the Sunshine Valley Dance Band. Everyone thinks it was just going to be like a dance band, and Hookie thinks it was jazz, but no. We were going to be avant-garde, and people would book us on the strength of the name, and we would shock them with our appalling performances. It never got off the ground, but through Mac's elder brother I got into Can, and then after Can, Amon Dul and New. I was into the punk rock before punk rock, which was the MC5 and the first Stooges album, which I bought from Kendall's in Manchester. Anything that wasn't disco. I later came to regret that opinion, but at the time disco was shit, and so it was anything that was a little bit long-haired, but not like the boys in the year above me.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.